All right, good morning. All right, let me just make sure that everybody can hear me, please. If you can type in on the chat, can you hear me? All right, it seems everybody can hear me. Excellent. Well, good morning again. Assalamu alaikum. My name is Zara'ed Mar'i. If you would be wondering probably why I look different and the name is different than Ayman. Well, Ayman asked me to be here on his place this morning. He had a little bit of a, I guess, virus on that affected his voice. He's doing well, alhamdulillah. Days, but he asked me to be in his place. First, just to introduce myself one more time. My name is Ra'ed Mar'i. All right, and I've been with Meirc for the past almost 8 years. I'm now a senior consultant and a partner with Meirc, doing training in Excel as well as other things in budgeting, planning, accounting and reporting, and accounting operations and closing and so forth. All right. Before that, also I was in the United States for almost 10 years. Worked there and got my MBA there, as well as my CPA and CMA. All right, let me just go right away to our topic. Modeling business data in Excel. Well, so what do we do here basically? Where do we go in this journey? The a lot of times our function as, let's say, our responsibility as professionals in the organization is actually to give data, to give, not give data, but rather to give more time, tools for management to make decisions. And a lot of times, unfortunately, we don't have this, crystal ball. Management does not have this crystal ball where they can use this to make decisions in the future. So they have to depend on data. Now, if you have that crystal ball, please maybe you can share with us maybe that the magic that you have or the trick you have. But we need to give data and the availability and how to present the data for management to make proper decisions. We need to present the data in a certain way that management can make proper decision and have can read the lines, can highlight let's say weaknesses and strengths. They can maybe build some kind of a assumptions, and they will see what are the result of these assumptions in this model. So this is where we come basically here, hopefully, to present and give some help to management. What we will doing basically here, we'll be talking about five main tools in Excel in business modeling, in data modeling. We'll start with a spinner, we'll go to a list box, checkbox and option button, and scenario manager. And you will see, notice that we'll start with analyzing the data and coming up with figures. We'll go through presenting the data through the graphs and the charts, and then we'll end also coming back to data and figures. So you have basically many ways to present the data, and you can let's say select the best way for you, and many things you can do with Excel. All right, so are you ready? Can you give me some yes so we can start? All right. All right. Thank you, Noura. Excellent. Thank you, Celine. All right, let's go and start. I'm going to go and now start sharing my screen with you so that you can see my Excel in a few seconds. All right. As we mentioned, the first thing we'll start with is scenario, or sorry, actually spinner. Now, the spinner, it's a way for me to look at many different variables, let's say, and how does the variable affect my results? So it's one way to do this, and looking at many assumptions or many variables. Let me see, I'm trying to connect my screen, my Excel with you in seconds. A lot of times, basically, what you will be working with is you have a set of assumptions, variables, that goes into your model. And we have right now, thank you. Okay, we have this now working with us. So basically, we have, these are our variables. So set of assumptions, tax rate, units sold, sales growth percentage, and so forth. And of course, all these are built into my model. So this is our model, our forecast. Of course, one of the ABC of Excel is never go here and enter 15000. You'll basically screw up the whole model. It has to be linked with the assumption that you have here. So that's why you have this here is linked to this cell, and all these depend on these cells and so forth. And that's why if we change anything in this variable in this model or this set of assumption, for example, let's say 12,000, as you will see, all these results will change when I click enter. All right, so that's the idea. So that's the, of course, it's a prerequisite of doing any of kind of modeling, especially in Spinner as well. Also, one thing just to mention, because we'll see this model in a way, also in the scenario manager, but you'll see that some of these cells we have here are already named. I'm not sure if Ayman have maybe discussed naming cells earlier, but basically we go here in what we call the name box, and we change the name from a B4 to sales growth percentage and so forth. So okay, so all this, that's why when you look at these formulas, it's linked as such. For example, tax rate, your tax. Okay. Now, what we will do basically, we want to come up with another set of assumptions, another set of variables. And we want to probably, in this case, we will be looking and we'll be having, see, I have somebody who maybe have a black screen. I'll come back to you in a minute. Patrick, okay, so I guess Patrick maybe have a little bit of a technical issue. I'll come back to you, Patrick, in a few seconds. My team here is will be helping me in getting a better screen. All right, basically, what we will have here, again, we would have probably a scenario where we're looking at, with management on a set of assumptions, and we work with this management or with the management team, and they will come and ask us questions. Okay, for example, what if the selling price go up to 10 and 11? What if the product cost goes down or goes up? What if the percentage change, and how this will affect my results, my forecast, my numbers right here? So it's a way for me to go and apply the changes to this variable, to these variables, right away at the spot. As we will see, we have another way of doing this, maybe in something that you call scenario manager. But this is the idea here, that we want to change, be able to change and apply these changes on the spot to these variables and see the results. So, in order for us to create the spinner, we need to have something in our ribbon that we call developer, which I don't have right now. I'm going to add it with you. Basically, if you have not used macros before, if you have not used what you call Spinner and other type of tools, will not be there available for you. So you have to go and maybe take a note on how you add a developer to your ribbon. So what we will do, we go to File, click on Options, and then Customize Ribbon. So you have here these different tabs, Customize Ribbon, and then to your right side under the main tabs here, developers. You can see all these are what you usually see in your ribbon. Developer is not clicked, so we check it. We need to click it, and then click OK. So now, if you can see here, I have my developer right here in the ribbon. So I would click on developer. I go to the middle, probably here under controls, there's something called insert controls. And then to the third one from the right, 1, 2, 3 from the right, there is called spin button form controls. I click on that and I can draw. Now you can see the cursor becomes a small plus sign. So in this case, I want to draw, let's say, a spinner next to my selling price. So I'll go right here and click and drag. Okay. It's my spinner. Next, what I need to do basically here, I need to right click, format control. Right click, format control, click on that. This is my screen here. I don't care about the others really here. Now, what do we have? Current value, 0. You can keep it like this and then change it later on. You can put it here, for example, 9. It's up to you. This is the current value that we have for this cell. The minimum, maximum, this is by default what Excel has. And it can give us some limitation later on. Talk about it. Incremental change is how much up and down will go. We can change that, but let's keep it as such the default. The main thing really here is the cell link. The cell link obviously is going to be linked to the cell that will change all this model, which is in this case the selling price. So this is my selling right here, the selling price. So click OK, click outside. Now you can see the change. Now see, it becomes now it's a like small hand. So if I go up back to 9, and then management will tell me to, so what happens if my price goes up to 12? And here you go. Of course, somebody will tell me that I could have just type in here right away, 12. So what's the big deal? See that? By mistake, I put 2 rather than 12. And then I don't want to be responsible for somebody having a heart attack from management once they see a price at 2. So I want to be basically to be more, you know, accurate in entering the data. Basically, a spinner will just do that. Much easier and also much fancier. So now you can, you know, go to management and say, we have something new for you to look at, right? So let's do another spinner. You can see, of course, we can do spinners for all these variables. For the sake of time, I'm going to do one more time, or one other type. We'll do it, let's say, for the unit sold. So same process, same steps almost. We go to developer, insert. Again, the spin button form control, this one, the third one from the right, click on it. And again, draw the spinner. I could have also copied the previous spinner over here. Same thing, and then I change the settings. So I go right here now, again, right click, format control, and the sell link will be the 15,000. Okay. All right, I have some comments before I do that. So could you repeat, please, from Al-Jawhara, and the options for the ribbon. All right, so I guess you get your answer then, Jawhara, from Khaled. Thank you, Khaled, for helping. All right, so I'm glad you're actually interacting on the chat. Excellent. So basically, I'm now here at the spinner, creating a spinner for the unit sold. And then once I'm at the sell link, I would go and create my sell link to the unit sold right here. Click OK. I can type in the 15 one more time and then see what we have here. So the idea, same thing. Now, if I go and click up and down, it will go up by 1, 2, go down by 1. Okay, that's fine. Does this make sense? You sit with management, you have the whole management team sitting with you, and then you say, what will happen if my units will go up by 1, by 2, by 3? Does not really make any sense. The reason I have this by 1 and 2, because once I went to my format control on the spinner, the incremental change is 1. So we need to change it, basically. We probably need to change it to, let's say, 1,000. Right? We can do that, yes. Click OK. Now, once I go 15,116, so I can go here up to where I want to have, until 30,000. Okay, see that it's working. Incremental is fine, but still I'm having some kind of limitation. You know, maybe management is so, let's say, you know, optimistic. They are so aggressive. They want to increase more than 30,000 units. Seems I'm have a problem here. Okay, the reason for that, if right click on it, format control. The reason for that, because I put incremental change 1,000, but then my maximum, my default maximum value is 30,000. I cannot change that, right? No, I cannot. I can go up. I cannot go up. I can go below, but I cannot go above the 30. So I need to have a solution for this problem. Well, if you've ever seen Man Sarbah Al-Million in Arabic, who wants to be a millionaire? Once a participant or somebody is stuck, he has 3 options, right? So he has, he can get a vote of the audience, which probably 90% of the times is wrong. He can eliminate one of the 2 maybe other options or answers. We don't have that situation here, but we can call a friend. Well, the friend here basically is Excel, another cell friend, another cell helper. Let's see what happens here. I want to go back and change this to 1 more time. All right. I can go back this here to 15,000. So my friend, my helper cell basically is right here. I'm going to highlight it for my reference, just for me to know what is my helper cell. I'm going to put some here a number, let's say it is 15. See what happens here. So this is my helper cell. I want to be able to use this cell for my spinner, where the result here becomes 15,000, meaning that I want to create a formula here taking this cell, and the result of this formula is 15,000. So probably you guessed it. I take that cell and then multiply it by 1,000, enter, and that's your 15,000, right? So if this becomes 16, then this will be 16,000 and so forth. So what I need to do basically here, the spinner have to be linked not to this original cell, let's say, but rather to my helper cell, my friend. So my cell link basically here is the cell link over here. So click OK. Then probably could I change that? Let's see. All right. So I can change this to 16. So once I go up, I'll change back because I've done this at the later stage. So I have to go back and redo my formula here, 17 over 6 or that cell times the 1,000. And then let me see that. Okay, so now the cell can go up to 30, no problem, or more than 30. And then my cell, 30,000, so no limitation here. Okay, so that's, of course, we can maybe take this out if you want to. No refill, and then you can even hide it. So it's not there anymore, right? It's not there, right? Okay, so that's the idea where you can use another cell to do your spinner. And probably this can be applied also to your ratios. For example, if you use an incremental of 1, it will be by 100%, which does not make any sense. Probably it should be by 1%. So you create another cell, for example, here for 40, and then your cell formula will be here, that reference cell, that helper cell, divided by 100, so that whenever you go 1, it will be to 41, 42%, and so forth. So for the sake of time, I'm not going to go over all these, but that's really the idea, that you, when you build a model like this and you present it with management, you have a spinner for all these values, and you come to say, okay, management will tell you, okay, what will happen if my units goes up to, let's say, to 26,000, and my price is up to 13, what will happen? And you can see the results are here right away. So that's basically one way of creating like a model that you check, you change the assumptions in your data, and you see the results right away through that tool that you call Spinner. All right. Time, are we ready to go to the other tool? All right, thank you, Khaled. Excellent. Yeah, let's go. Let's go here, and let's go to the other one, list box modeling. Thank you, Darin. All right. Now, my second tip, or my second tool right here, basically, is the list box modeling. Now, the idea is you would have certain data. For example, this can be coming from maybe linked with this with the system, integrated with the system, linked from a different file with a pivot table from another source. And then you want to use this area here to do your model, to present your model. So as I mentioned, the first tool, Spinner, it was basically looking at the data itself. Now we're going to come up with a presentation of the data. A lot of times management, in order for them to really see big picture, to see to be able to make a decision, they need to see at the graph, like a presentation summary of the whole data, not the detail. So in order for us to do that, we're going to use a list box model associated with what you call a function that we're going to explain right now. It's called choose function. This is only about a way for me to present the data and summarize the data in a graph. All right. So I'm going to use what you call the choose function. And let me just explain the choose function in just a few seconds right here. Let's say I have the following list. Let's say red, yellow, blue. All right. And I have something called here index number, let's say. Now, I want to have a function that will tell me, based on this cell value here, either give me red or yellow or blue. Based on what? Well, based on the value that we have here. For example, if this is 1, then the first value here is red, so give me red. If this is two, then give me yellow, and so forth. So we use, in this case, we use what we call choose function. Choose, basically, it's like a cousin of the VLOOKUP. If you have probably used VLOOKUP before, you look at a certain reference and you take the, let's say, the result, the idea or the result out of it. Well, here, the choose is another reference, let's say, another function to be used the same thing, but it's like an offshoot or spring of it. But let me explain the choose, equal sign, choose. All right. And let me expand the screen over here. And let's see what we have. What's this choose function? It asks me for the index number. So the index number is something right here. This is my index number. C6, for example. Now, the values. What are the values? Based on this one, value 1 basically is the first one, the red. Value 2, yellow. Value 3 is blue. Now, the order, the sequence of each of these cells that I've created here or selected here is very important because it will have the following. Anytime this equals 1, this means that I have this. Anytime this equals 2 or value 2, this will be the yellow and so forth. All right. I have a comment from Mr. Akram. He cannot see the Excel screen. We need to refresh, my friend. Maybe you need to sign in, sign out, and sign in back again. I think this should solve your issue. Okay, if not, please let me know. All right. Okay, so this is our, again, so value 1, value 2, value 3 is based on these, the order that we have here. So click OK. So if this is 1, then give me the value 1, which is red. If this is 3, then give me blue. Again, why? Because once I come back here, this is what? This is value 3. What's value 3? C4. C4 is blue. Okay. Fine. Let's see how we can apply this choose function in our model. My index number right here. So this is why my number. And it is A2, or I've named it index number. You can kind of keep the name as it is. You can show it a different name, anything. But basically, this is my index that will be used in the function. So what do I have here? I have a set of data. This is for revenues. And then you have cost of sales, operating expenses, the other income expense, and the net income. As an example, of course, you have any other representation of data that you like, as you like. And also in our company, we have, let's say, 4 different branches or regions or divisions, segments, whatever the case. So I'm presenting the data for each of these accounts, revenues, cost of sales, net income, and so forth, based on all regions, the whole company, for example, east, north, south, west regions, as an example. So on number 1, as we will see later on, it will be applied to the revenues. For example, the revenues here will be presented as revenue, as 1. The cost of sales will be based on, or rather, sorry, the number 1 will be presented as the regions. So number 1 is for the all regions, number 2 is for the east, and so forth. But I want to present this data or summarize this data on this, what you call shadow data. Let's use the choose function there. So equal sign, choose. Now the index number is basically this. This is my trigger. This is my, base. Let's say index number right here, comma. Now I'm looking for what? For revenues. I want to assign different values for the revenues or the regions within the revenues. I cannot do this, for example. I cannot have multiple range of cells. This will not be, allowed basically in Excel for this choose function. So it have to be only a particular cell, which is in this case all regions. Right here, and then either I could put a, or can go into control on my keyboard to select value 2, value 3, value 4, and value 5. Enter. Let's see what we have here. So choose what? Based on this trigger number or in this number, I have 1 for what? Value 1. What's value 1? It is B15. What's B15? It is all regions Jan revenue. So if I put this, for example, here as 5, what do we have? 63 is what? Is the 63, 74, number 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, right? So that's basically the West, the revenue for January in the West region, and so forth. So basically, this, based on the index number, I would have different regions, based on different value that I have, value 1, 2, 3, and 4, and so forth. So once I'm done, I can now copy and paste for the others. And let me do the same thing now. We can probably see this in more, and you can practice more once we go into the other accounts. Let me do cost of sales. So again, choose. So index number, same cell, comma, and then I choose now cost of sales. I apply value one for all regions. It have to be consistent, of course. So value one for all regions, and then control my value two for east, north, south, and value five for west. Enter. And that's value five. Why? Because my index number here is value five. Let me do now the others. So choose index number, comma. This is the operating says this is value one, two, three, four, and five. Again, you have to select them one at a time. You cannot go select a whole range. It has to be one at a time because each one, each cell represents a value assigned from the index number. So now it's other operating expense and income. Again, value one, two, three, four, and five. And then the last one, choose for the net income. Based on this index number, giving me the value one for all regions net income. Then control on the keyboard, value two, three, four, and five. Okay, again, let me test this. So five have net income 16,000. That's my west. If I go back, let's say here to number two, this should give me the east region. So revenue 67 right here, net income 17 right here. Okay, so I'm okay with this. I can now just copy and paste. All right, let me just save so I'm on the safe side. All right, so all what we create here, just a step for me to create what we call the list box model. So what we do here, basically, I want to present five graphs that create or present the revenues, cost of sales, and so for these months, and also for these regions. So what I do, I'm going to start from here, from this blank spot, and again select the revenues only, and then select the months. So that's my selection, only revenues and the months. I go to insert my graph. For example, I'm going to start with a column graph, and that's my first graph. Now I want to put basically a presentation of this on a different sheet, right? For example, here. For example, right here, and then, okay, so this is my graph, and I'll go and control X to cut this graph, put it on this new sheet. For example, I'm gonna put it right here at the top. Okay. Now the idea is to create five different sheets, or five different graphs. I have one, two, three, four, five. These are my accounts. So I want to have five different graphs. So I want to probably what usually we discuss in the training, our training programs, which is again, everybody would have their own laptop and they would do everything because they will practice all these on the spot right away. And we do it in a slower pace as well. But the idea is that once you have that, you will create those graphs. And also we go through some kind of techniques, management techniques on how to clean up these graphs. But this is not our discussion for now. So let's take it as an example, and then we'll, to only highlight the idea of list box model. So once I clean up my data, my graph, let's say, I go and replicate that five times. So control, I click on it, and then control C, control V here, control V here to paste. So I'll paste it one more time here, and one more time here. Remember, I have five representing revenues. Of course, this doesn't make sense. I need cost of sale, I need the expenses and income and so forth. So I go here in each of these graphs. Now this is for revenue. I go to the second one, and I try to select the data for the second problem. All right, I have another comment from Taysir. You lost my voice. Again, if you still cannot hear me, I have to type it in then. Let's see, chat. Okay, so Taysir. All right, can you make sure that, can everybody listen to me? Can you hear me, please? Okay. If you have any, please restart your webinar. Just to log out. All right, so thank you. All right. So if you, if they see or still cannot hear me, hopefully you can see the note. All right, so let me just go back to our discussion. So what we're basically we're doing, we have our revenues right here. We want to now select this graph to present our cost of sales. So now I'm in the second graph. I would go right click select data, and then obviously it's selecting the revenue. I want to change that, so you edit this, the series here. So you go and edit. Now it is the cost of sales, so it's already highlighted for you, ready for you to select the cost of sales. Go right away, select cost of sales. I can now go to the series values. I can do it easier and better with my tab on the keyboard. Tab. So now it's selected, ready for me to go and select the cost of sales values. So this is my Jan to December cost of sales. Click OK. Click OK. Now it is cost of sale, different graph. And then I'll do the same thing here. So this is right click on the third graph, select data, edit, operating expenses in the series name, tab on the keyboard to go select the values, and the values will be for operating expenses. Click OK. Click OK. Operating expenses. And then go to the fourth one, right click, edit. Now I need to get the other operating expense, and then tab to go to the series values. It will be the values for the operating expense and income. Click OK and OK one more time. And then you have your last one. Again, right click on the graph, select data, and then edit from here, edit. Net income is my series name. And then tab values are the net income values from January until December. And click OK. You have basically here created five different graphs, right? Five different graphs, and you are presenting all these graphs for, in this case, for what? For two, right? So if this is number one, my graphs will be different. They changed. So that's the idea of the list box. This is where the list box comes, basically. I want to have a list. It's called list box, right? I have a list box where I can go and select what other regions I want to present into these graphs. In this case, I would go now, and let me just save to make sure that I'm okay. So I go here in this blank area. I go back to developer, insert, and then the second one from the right. It's called list box. If you put your cursor on it, it becomes list box. Click on it. Now you just draw a box. All right, so we go right click on this list box, format control. Now, input range is what? I need to present the revenues, cost of sales, operating, and then income for the different regions. So the input range are the different regions. So I can go right back to my model right here, anywhere, and just select, for example, these. This is my list or input range. The cell link that will make this whole data change is based on what? My index number, right? So my cell link here is the index number value that we have here. I can do the shading if I want to, and click OK to show it. Don't worry, it's fine, no problem. It's just not selected yet. So if we go to all regions, here you go. I'm back with those graphs. So the east, north, south, and west. Of course, again, as I mentioned, we didn't have time to make this a bit, let's say look nicer. So previously I have worked on this earlier, and that you can see much nicer way to present it. Let's say slightly with the here, so I can see right away different graphs. And again, the idea what here management is looking for a summarized data in a nice way. You are telling them, okay, what we have here, these are the different, the main components of your income statement, for example, and for what? All regions, here you go. south, here we go. So again, it's a nice way to present your data for management for them to make decisions, hopefully. All right. Okay, so this is our list box model. So this is the second tool that we talked about. We talked about the spinner first. We talked about the list box. I hope you liked it. All right, I hope you liked it. If you liked it, please say yes. All right, next, what we will do, we'll go to the checkbox model. Let me just open this. All right, thank you, Khaled. Yes, it is nice. Thank you, Hanin. Dareen, thank you. Basically, it's a nice way to, you know, to present the data, to summarize the data. A lot of times, you know, management is not looking for the pure number because it's huge data. You want to present it in a certain way. So that's the idea. All right. Let me go back now and do the third model technique, which is the checkbox model. Now, as we said, we are working with certain data. Again, this data can come from the system, from integrated automatically with the system, can be copy and paste, can be coming from pivot, can be anything. So this is original data, and this is basically, you can say, it's like live data, changing data. What you do, you come, example here, to create your model, you create what you call a shadow data, where you present this data only for the sake of creating that, those graph or this graph for you to work with. So in this particular example here, what we will do, I want to look at this cell, and I guess I have a comment from Safan, whether we can send you these files. Yes, of course we can. Just I think probably the email will be registered with us already, so we will send you an email at the end of the webinar. So you can get those files. Of course, this webinar will be available on the website shortly after we finish. The next week, I believe. So I'll send you the files in meantime, and then anytime with you or your team, you can access those webinars. This one and the previous, all the other webinars are on our website, meirc.com, and it will be under resources. I believe you have webinars there for previous Excel and other webinars, other topics. So yes, you can have this file, you can practice, you can go back, you know, and forth anytime you want. And of course, at the end, you can send us an email, send me an email or call me. We'll be glad to help you out. All right, so what do we have here? Basically, we have, again, the shadow data, and we want to present this data so that we can create our model. Now, what I want to do, I want to create this shadow data representation through a function called if statement. Now, if you have not used if statement, don't worry, we're going to have just a simple if statement. But let me just explain quickly what does an if statement mean. Now, what I will do basically here, I'm going to make this either, I'm going to assign, let's say, either true or false, meaning that it's called checkbox. So check meaning it's selected or not selected. So yes or no, or true or false. We'll see what this means in a few minutes. So if I say this is true, let's say I'm going to put here true, okay? Right, now I'm going to do a test, let's say, if. So if statement is a logical test, all right? Logical test, let me put it right here. So logical test is what? If this cell, I'm testing, I'm figuring out, let me see. Does this cell equal true? Now, is the result of this test, is it true or false? Is it yes or no? It is true or not? It is true, it is correct, right? So the value, if it is true, then give me this number here, right? Which is, if it is true for 2012 here, you don't see, but this is 2012, then give me January revenue or data or amount for 2012. If it is not true, meaning that this is not, the value here is not true, it is false, it is blank, it is something else, then just give me zero. Got the idea? So click OK, let me see. If they change something here, this is, let's say, zero, or this is blank, or this is false, it is zero. Why? Because I said, if this is true, then give me the value of false, which is zero. If it is true, give me the C18, which is Jan 2012 number, which is true, here we go, yes. So I want to apply the same thing, where I represent each of these true and false for each of these years, and the data for that year. So I want to be able to copy and paste. So probably maybe you're familiar probably with the how to make a certain cell constant. Okay, so I'll go here to A11, which is this one, A11. I want to make that column A constant. I want to be able to copy and paste to the other columns and the down to the other rows. So I'll go here, either you add a dollar sign, or you can put F4 once, add it both to your rows and columns, another F4 only for the rows, another F4 only for the column. So when I go here, copy and paste, it will give me still refer to the A11, as you can see. If I go and copy and paste down, it still shows now to the proper year, A14, which is what I need. So let me test this. So true here, yes, true, and it does give me, let's say, for 2013, that's my 1,200 here. For 2015, if it is true, then it gives me 1674, which is December for 2015. All right, now, again, all this is just about trying to represent this data to management for them to look at it. So I want to go now and select one, all this data right away. Oops, I'm sorry. So all this data right here, and create one single, let's say, graph for it. So I'm selecting all this data. I go to insert, again, from a graph, any graph you can choose. I want to put it into different sheet, Control X on the graph, and then I can put it somewhere probably here, Control V. Let me just make this a bit bigger for us to see it better. Okay, that's more like it. All right. Okay. All right. All right. So now what do we have here? Look at this. This is all the years. I want to be able to select different years. This is where the checkbox comes into place. So I go to developer. This is a very, very important really tool for or button for modeling. Developer. Click on developer one more time. I would go here, insert, and then it's called checkbox from the name check. You can see the checkbox. Now I create again, same thing, just like we did before in the spinner and the list box. You draw a box like this. It's my checkbox. I right click on it and again, format control. Now what's here? This is the cell link. I don't care about this, the others. Don't worry about it. So basically here, the cell link, meaning what is the checkbox I want to select? It is the years, different years. What is changing in my model? Is true and false? It is these, either it is selected or not selected. So probably here I'm going to select for 2012, this particular cell, A11. I can do 3D shading just for the sake of looking of the box. Click OK. Now I go back here, edit text, so that I can say that this is what this is 2012. Look at this. If I click it, you'll see 2012. 2012 data is in the blue, right? It's a blue column. Uncheck it, it's gone. Why? Because when I check it, it is there as true. If I don't check it, it goes there as false. That's the error of a checkbox. It assigns in that cell link, when we did the cell link right here, it assigns a certain value from the name checkbox. It's basically either check that or don't, you select that or don't, you do yes or no, you do true or false. So it gives you check, it is true, uncheck, false. And that's why your data will be here, zero or not represented. So we need to do the same thing now with the other. So I can probably just take this and copy it over right here. Go to paste and then do this for 2013 and then format control, oops, sorry. Format control, cell link now will be 12 or A12 rather. So that's okay. You can see here 2013 in red. It comes back again. This is in 2013 in red. All right. Same thing, we do it with the other. Okay. So right here, this is for 2014. And I need to change all of my format control. Don't forget format control to select a particular cell for that, which is 2014 trigger. Let me test it. Yes, 2014, the green one. And the last one, I go copy and paste. Of course, we can always do this from here. Same thing, insert, the checkbox one more time and you draw it. The only thing that when you draw a box one more time, slightly will be different size maybe from the other one. So that's why you can see it's better to see, to use it from the previous one and just copy and paste 2015. And then right click, format control, the cell link will be right here for 2015. This is just to make it nice, make it nicer. And here you go. Okay, so probably I can probably just do something like this right here one more time just to make it nicer. Okay, and here you can see, okay, you know, management is looking around and they say, okay, what happens back in, let's say, 2012 compared to 2013? And here you go. And they will tell you, let me see, if you add 2014 to the picture, what will happen? And you can see a certain trend and certain ups and downs. And then let's say 2015 is our most recent, 2012 is not relevant, so I take it out. And you can probably, again, answer or probably come up with, for management to come up with questions, which is maybe on the negative side here for you, probably have to go back and do some research, huh? Some more work for you. But again, you can see how much additional benefit you can give to your management, to people who are looking at this, where you present the data and they come up with more questions and maybe need for investigation for making decisions. All right, so this brings basically our discussion to the checkbox to an end in this case. Now, the second or the following one is the option button modeling. All right, here we go. This is option button modeling. Now, in this case, we're going to represent this data also into one graph that has different, let's say, accounts as well. So it's another way, maybe very similar in this case to the checkbox, but we'll see some differences here. Okay. Now, what do we have? We have data again for sales, expenses, and net income again for each of these years. As I mentioned, this is coming can come from the system or through the system. I'm using this only for shadow data. I'll call it shadow data just to show the presentation or the graphs. Now, I'm going to create if statement. Now, slightly more, let's say one more step if statement, not the simple if statement that we have in the previous exercise or previous checkbox model. It's basically nested if statement, more than one scenario. Let's see what happens here. My trigger is only about this. So if this is one, give me sales information. If this is two, then give me expenses. If this is three, then give me net income. If this is four, it's of course not there, it's not zero, not applicable, right? So this is what I need to do here. Let's say quarter one, if equal sign, if. Now what's the logical test? Does this trigger, again, I called it trigger already, so okay, that's the name trigger. Does this trigger equal what? One. Now, if it equals one, what do you want to have? Comma, what's the value of true? Well, if this is one, then give me sales for 2015, right? So this is 399 right here. Right. Comma, if this value is false, meaning this trigger does not equal one, then I need to check, because if it equals two, it will be expensive, equal three, it will be net income, right? So I need to do one more if statement here. So if the value is false, if this trigger does not equal one, give me one more test. If the trigger, this one, equals two, then give me what? What's the value of true? Give me the comma. If this is false, again, it's not one, it's not two. If it's three, then give me another test. So if this trigger equals three, comma, give me the net income. Got the idea? Now, if this is false, then we said zero. Just do not give me anything. Now, if look at this, if I go and close the bracket, you see that description of the if statement goes away, and once it's gone, it's mean that I've satisfied all the requirements for these if statements. Click OK. Now one is 399. If I go and change this to number two, it is 219, which is revenue for expenses, rather for 2015. If I put this as three, then it is 179, which is the net income. If I put this as a four, zero, because if it does not equal any of one, two, three, then we said it is zero, false. All right. But what I need to do basically just go and copy and paste over here to the other. You can see everything is copied. And it all depends on this cell that we called trigger. We named it as trigger. All right, next I will do is I'm going to create a graph for all these quarters. So insert, go right here, Control X, I'm gonna put it into different sheet, for example, right here. Okay. Excuse me, sorry. Let me just make this. Okay. So now I want to use one more time. I would go to the developer to have what you call option button. So I go to developer, insert. First one to the right, option button. So this is my first option button. Again, I would go right click, format control, and then the main thing is the cell link. The cell link now, it is that option button based on this one right here. Click OK. So what do we have here? If you click on it, it gives us what? Sales, right? So basically this applies as one. So it's giving me the sales number here. So I can go here and add a text to name it as sales. All right, let me just take this small S out. All right, okay. Now go and copy and paste. I want to go and click on something else. I want to see the, say the expenses. So I take that and copy one more time. Look at this, if you want to click on it, give me expenses. Meaning that this option button, once I create it once, I go to format control, the cell link is the same, right? So the order or how many times you create it, an option button, basically it creates or puts a value for it. So the second time I create it, this is my second option button, right? It gives this value of 2. So this basically is my expenses. If I go and do it one more time from here, or I can copy and paste from the developer, same thing. I go here, I'm gonna call this net income. Look at this, click on it, it is net income. Again, so the option button, the thing about it, basically, once you create it, once applies the value 1. You create it one more time, it applies the value of 2, applies the value of 3, and so forth. And we said, if this is 1, then give me sales, and that's why what sales is. If you put net income, then it assigns a trigger value of 3, which is the net income. That's my trigger, 3 equals the net income, and so forth. All right, so that's the idea where you can use this way of presenting the data in a way so that people can look at different, you can say, from this. All right, so this is our checkbox model. All right, we're at around 50 minutes in our almost our presentation, so that gives us good time for us to do the last technique here, and then we have maybe like around 5 minutes or so for questions and answers if you have any. And so let me and just close this and go to the last one, which is scenario manager. Now you've seen this before, right? So remember, we have these different set of assumptions, and based on these assumptions changing, I have different values. Well, in the first thing we talked about, the spinner was about having a way to go on the spot, changing the values here, and you see the results on the spot on the model itself. This is where you look at management and they will tell you, we're not quite sure what will happen. You just give us many different, let's say, set of assumptions, up and down, and growth, and sales, and price, and so forth, and we'll see what happens. So they want to look at the data or the results on the same model. They're not sure exactly what to do. And the second, tool here, which is called Scenario Manager, basically, I work with this. I already have, you know, sat with my management team, let's say with my team, with management. They decided probably we think this is what will happen based on these assumptions, which we think this is what will be the most likely, let's say, assumptions. This will be the result. But in order for us to have mitigation of my risk, because we don't have that crystal ball. We think that the units will be at 15,000, but we're not quite sure. We don't have that crystal ball, basically. That's why we come back and say, what if? What if we have another set of assumptions? What if we have another scenario where all things are much better than expected? Alhamdulillah, mashallah, things are excellent and growth in the economy, in the country, everything is excellent. What will be the set of assumptions and what will be the result? And then we have to be also on the other side thinking about what will happen if things go even more worse. What will happen if we have another set of assumptions and the results? So let me quickly just go and do this. In this case, we're going to go to data. And again, what if analysis? So you can see the logic behind putting scenario manager with what if analysis. So data, what if analysis, scenario manager. This is my screen. You can add. So again, I have my scenario name. So this is where you give a name for your scenario. Let's say first I'm going to do best case scenario. You can do like plan A, you can do model one, model two. So you can just give it a name, any name. Now the changing cells, I'm going to do tab to go to the changing cells. Basically these are assumptions, right? Now depending on your case, what's your set of assumptions in the best case scenario? Are all will be variable changing, or maybe let's say, or some, and you can, for example, for the sake of our time, I'm going to do only those three. Click OK. Remember the first thing we talked about actually in this discussion, that we have named these cells, and you can see the benefit of that. Now, units sold. Otherwise, if you have none, if you have not named a particular cell, it will show as B3 and B4 and B5 and so forth. So when I have units sold, okay, now you put your set of values. What will be, based on your best case scenario, your unit sold? Okay, now we have 20,000. Now this is what you can do yourself or with management. Let's say sales growth percentage, let's say it is now at 12%. Price is up to 11. Okay, let's see, let me add one more scenario right now. So we go to add. Now this is, God help us, scenario. This is worst case scenario. This is hopefully will not happen, but we have to be ready for it as well. So you want to have same set of assumptions? You can. Maybe for comparability. Or maybe you have plan A is units sold will be changing and the price will be changing, but plan B would be about the cost structure. Maybe the cost is changing, cost percentage growth will be changing and so forth. So it's up to you. But let's keep it as it is. We click OK. Now we put our worst case figures or values that we expect. So this might go down to, let's say, 11,000 units. Sales growth is only at 5%, and the price, let's say, is even, I have to do some discount for my customers at, let's say, at 8. You can do many multiple scenarios. I think, if I'm not mistaken, maybe 32 scenarios, but again, who needs that much, probably, yeah. But you can have 5, 6, probably, easy. Click OK, and here we go. If you want to add one more scenario, you can do that. If you want to delete, if you want to edit your assumptions that you have put in, the values, you can do that from here. The main thing to do, or actually not to do, let me repeat, the main thing not to do is click on show. Do not click on show, please, because this will show this particular scenario on the original model. Not exactly what I need. I need to keep this. This is my most likely. This is what I would think will happen. I need to have one more sheet over here that will tell me what if I have best case or worst case scenarios. So do not click show, rather click on summary. So I want to summarize. I don't want to have the whole thing basically one more time. Just summarize what will be the main results, probably say profits, right? So my result sales is the profit. How will these different scenarios affect my profit? Click OK, and see now will be new sheet coming in. So click OK. We have here original model, and this is my scenario summary. Let me just take this here. This is my current, this is my most likely, this is my probable scenario that will happen, and this is my best case, worst case. And these are the assumptions that have changed from the original model. And these are the results here. Best case, worst case, and the original model. And at least we look at even the worst case scenario, alhamdulillah, we have something to say to pay our bills, basically, to have profit rather than and loss. And that's the idea. So you put a plan. Or what will happen if that's the situation? Maybe it's too low of a profit, and this will my owners will be really dissatisfied. So we need to do something about it. And this is where you take it, the steps with your management, with your planning team, to see what will happen if that scenario really applies. Of course, one last thing to mention here is that this is it's a static report. It's not dynamic. So if you go back and change your assumptions right here, for example, to 16, it has nothing to do with your scenario. Still the same, data. So this is slightly different than the spinner. This is where you can check your or choose your tool. That will be the scenario manager. All right. Okay, well, that's basically, thank you for your time. Thank you for being here for almost 1 hour and going all these different tools and modeling in Excel. Let me go right here and see if you have any questions. Give you around maybe 5 minutes if you like, if you have any questions. All right, let me see some comments that I've missed. I was busy doing the Excel. I missed it. Thank you again, everybody. Thank you, Jawhara, Safan, Khalid, Carla, Al Jawhara. Can we update it? I guess, did they answer this question? Meaning that, can we update? Well, you talk about the scenario manager, right? I'm assuming that you talk about the scenario manager. Well, the scenario manager, as I mentioned, it is like a static report. Now, what you can do, you can easily come back here to the original model, go back to your data, what if analysis, and scenario manager, okay, and edit. You can edit, let's say, you're changing cells, for example, for the worst case scenario. Click OK. Let me put now. This is much better, much worse situation. Let's say it is 8,000 units, and it's only growth of, let's say, 3%, and the price even goes down to, well, maybe let's give it at 8. Okay. Click OK. Now you go do summary. Same thing. So basically, Excel remembers your last selection. So not much of additional work that you have to do. Click OK. Now you have the second scenario. So that's my second scenario, and you have here our results one more time, changing based on what I've done in the second scenario. So it's still, it is, again, it is not dynamic, meaning it is not particularly, I guess I missed here zero, that's why. But it's not particularly dynamic, meaning that does not reflect any new values per se, not in the model, but you can easily go back anytime from your scenario manager and change and just do the summary. So does not take really long time to do that. I hope I answered your question, Al-Jawhara. Thank you, Khalid. Thank you, Osama. Let me just see if I can read this. If possible, to have in addition an Excel document showing the steps of these formulas. Let me see what I can do. Of course, we'll try to give you something meaningful, something complete for you. Yes, I'll try to. In our Excel programs, we have in Meirc, we have like 5 days of Excel, or you can do it in-house earlier, or a shorter period of day of time. But we have all this happening in a slower pace with a lot of exercises, because if you don't really practice it yourself, it will not be able to master it, let's say. We give much more, let's say, references and resources. But yes, Carl, I'll share with everybody section of what we give out related to this business model. All right, see. Thank you, Al-Jawhara. Thank you one more time. Great, find this helpful. Thank you, Darin. I guess that'll be it. Thank you so much, everybody. Again, the webinar copy of this will be available on on the website, ourmeirc.com, and within a week or so, I'll send these files for you shortly as well, in a couple of days maximum. And again, if you need to keep in touch with me, you can always email me at rmeirc@meirc.com. And can always also look at our portfolio of programs for the finance and accounting we have under Meirc.com, we have, we go to accounting and finance category, we have probably one of the largest offerings within this category in the region. So please have a look at that. And if you have any questions about anything, please do let us know. Safwan, yes, you can ask questions after you do your practice. So don't worry, I'm not going to leave you there in the dry. So of course, anytime once I send you those files, if you have any doubt about anything, please go ahead and do let me know. Send me email, call me. I'll be glad to help anybody. No issues here, no problem, of course. All right, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much. Excellent participation. Hopefully to see you in future webinars with Meirc. Good morning and bye-bye. Meirc.com.